In this lesson, we're going to talk about damaged water or polluted water. Previously, we've talked about water quality issues from natural human activities, wastewater, excrement, and also animal activities. We also talked about water quality issues from naturally occurring compounds in groundwater. But in today's lesson, we're going to talk about damaged or polluted water, and this is a result of industrial activities that occur in a nation. As a nation industrializes, more chemical processes, and there are a number of sources of potential water quality concerns that emerge from those activities. And we'll talk about three categories. We'll talk about nutrients, we'll talk about toxic organic compounds, and we'll talk about heavy metals. So the first category of compounds of concern, contaminants, are nutrients, specifically nitrogen and phosphorus. And how these often get into the environment are through, for example, agricultural activities, fertilizers. Fertilizers are high in nitrogen and phosphorus, and that helps the plants to grow. However, if not all that nitrogen and phosphorus that's applied gets taken up by the plants, some of that can end up getting into the water, the surface water, the groundwater. And this can cause several concerns. First, let's look at nitrogen. Nitrogen can get into the water and can go from ammonia to nitrate. And nitrate in groundwater, specifically, can cause a health concern, a concern that we call methemoglobinemia. I'll say that again, methemoglobinemia, or otherwise known as blue baby syndrome. The nitrate can get into the body and can affect the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood and can actually cause a blue appearance, and thus the name blue baby syndrome. And this can be fatal in infants if the nitrate level is sufficiently high. And so this is a concern that can come from nutrients in the environment. The second nutrient of concern is phosphorus. And phosphorus can go into the receiving body of water, for example, a lake, and the phosphorus may be the limiting nutrient to algae growth. And so you may see a massive growth of algae, what we call an algal bloom. And this can impact the environment in several ways. As the algae grow, and then diurnally, daily cycle, they grow, and then they die. And as they go through this process, they can consume the oxygen in the water and can make the water not so attractive. It can even result in death of fish, for example. And so that can be due to the phosphorus. The phosphorus can come from fertilizers. The phosphorus historically could come from detergents, laundry detergents. We would add a compound called tripolyphosphates to help bind the hardness in the water. Hardness, calcium, and magnesium could precipitate the soaps and reduce the cleaning efficiency of the soaps, the detergents. And so this tripolyphosphate would bind that calcium and magnesium and thus prevent the precipitation of this soap. And this, we call that water hard water because of its impact on the soap. So nitrogen and phosphorus are two nutrients that can result from human activities, fertilizers, that can have a negative impact upon water quality. And when that fertilizer is spread out on the field, the farmland, we call that a non-point source of water pollution. It's a non-point because you can't point and say that right there, that's the pipe or that's the place that's causing the water contamination. It's a very dispersed or widely spread out or a non-point source of pollution. In contrast, the next compounds that we'll talk about are toxic organic compounds. And we might think of compounds like PCBs, polychlorinated biphenyls. These are compounds that were discovered as part of the organic chemistry revolution that occurred in the 20th century. So these PCBs had very favorable properties. They were great insulators, and so they were used widely in electrical systems as insulators. And they also had a low potential to ignite, to cause flames, to combust. And so these were very desirable properties and made them very popular. However, what we didn't realize at the time was that these compounds could also be potential carcinogens, could potentially cause the formation of cancers. And so we recognized initially the positive aspects without yet understanding some of the negative aspects. Another class of compounds that fall into a similar category is pesticides. And one of the better known pesticides in this category would be DDT, dichlorodiphenyl trichloroethane. Again, a chemical that came out of the organic chemistry revolution. And very effective insecticide. Very effective at killing mosquitoes. And that's actually proved to save a lot of lives. You see, mosquitoes carry malaria. And malaria can cause a lot of deaths. It does around the world. And so the DDT that kills mosquitoes prevented the spread of malaria. And so it was widely hailed as a wonderful advance, saved a countless number of lives. What we didn't realize at the time was that the DDT also affected the reproduction in the bird population. And all of a sudden, as a result of DDT being used in the environment, the number of birds began to decline. And Rachel Carson wrote a famous book called Silent Spring. Silent Spring. In the springtime, it was silent because the bird population had declined to the point where there weren't so many birds to be singing in the spring. And this was a side effect of the use of DDT. So once again, we initially understood the positive effects, but it wasn't until later that we began to recognize the negative effects. Two other examples of toxic organic chemicals. And one would be chlorinated solvents. These are solvents that are, again, an outgrowth of the organic chemistry revolution. For example, tetrachloroethane, or perchloroethane, also known as PCE. Widely used as a solvent, very effective at degreasing and paint stripping, widely used in many operations. And fortunately, as with any chemical, this PCE, as it was used, found its way into the environment. And it would get into the groundwater, for example. And there's a movie from many years ago that talks about this situation where this PCE got into the groundwater and it impacted the water supply of a community. And the movie was called Civil Action. John Travolta starred in this movie. And so again, it was an example of an organic chemical that was very effective at its intended purpose, but it's also a potential carcinogen. And then the final class of organic compounds we'll talk about are pharmaceuticals. Drugs, the active ingredients in drugs are pharmaceuticals. And these obviously have great health benefits, but these go through the body and come out of the body often unaltered. And they go through the wastewater treatment plant, potentially unaltered, and they make their way into the environment. And there's uncertainty about the long-term effects of low levels of these pharmaceuticals in the environment. So in all these cases, we have chemicals that were developed as a result of organic chemistry, and we see the positive benefits, but we also have to be aware of the potential negative effects on the environment and on human health. The third class of compounds we want to talk about are heavy metals. Heavy metals are used widely in industrial activities. For example, chrome-plated bumpers is the example that comes to my mind. Metal plating, many times we metal plate chromium and other metals, copper plating, that helps to protect the surface of the metals and extends their usefulness and their lifetime. But these heavy metals can find their way into the environment. And so just to cite one other movie, this one is a little more recent. People may remember this movie a little bit better than the Civil Action movie, and that's the movie Aaron Brockovich. And this was a movie where chromium got into the environment. It was used in an energy production process, and it got into the environment, got into the groundwater, and it made it to the water supply of a community. And there were elevated incidents of cancer in this community. So we see the example of heavy metals getting into the environment, having a very positive, beneficial use, but then also have to be aware of the potential health and environmental concerns. In northeast Oklahoma, we have an area called Tar Creek, former lead and zinc mines in the northeast part of the state. And as a result of those mining activities and the aftermath of those activities, we have heavy metals that have gotten into the waters in the area around Tar Creek. And my colleague, Dr. Bob Nairn, is doing work on engineered treatment wetlands to help take that water and help remove those metal in engineered wetlands so the water going into the receiving streams is of a much higher quality and has a less effect on the environment and human health. And so that would be an example for heavy metals. So we see in all of these cases that these chemical processes produce materials that are very helpful to mankind, but there's potential side effects. And so this leads to the concept that we call sustainable development. Development is good because development reduces infant mortality. Development allows us to have longer lifetimes. But that development also can have potential side effects, and so we need sustainable development. Development where we benefit from the positive aspects of the industrial activities, but we understand the potential negative effects on the environment, and we learn from lessons of history so that when we develop new products, we take into account green chemistry, green processing as an effort to, as we develop new compounds, that we make sure that we reduce the potential risk to the environment and human health. But we certainly want the positive aspects, and so we certainly want the development, but in a sustainable way. And so an example, I think, of this is Thailand. We happen to be part of a cooperative graduate program at Chulalongkorn Longhorn University in Bangkok, Thailand. University of Oklahoma, along with several other universities, helped to deliver graduate programs in chemical engineering, developing new chemical processes, helping to expand the chemical industry in Thailand, but at the same time, environmental engineering. Let's understand the potential consequences of the environment, and while we're growing the industry, let's also grow the environmental awareness so that we can have sustainable development. And this is a lesson that many other countries can benefit from. As China, as India, as Brazil begin to expand their industrial activities, they need to do it from a sustainable way so that they have the benefits of development in the industrial sector while mitigating, minimizing potential concerns to human health and the environment.